following program is from NET, the National Educational Television Network.
This is Black Journal, program number one. It is our aim in the next hour and in the coming months to report and review the events, the dreams, the dilemmas of Black America and Black Americans. Shortly before his tragic death, Dr. Martin Luther King was invited by the graduating class of Harvard University to speak at their class day ceremonies. This afternoon, his widow, Mrs. Coretta King, went to Harvard to speak in his place. Here with a story from Cambridge, Massachusetts, is Ponchita Pierce of Ebony Magazine.
Traditionally, class day here means a ceremony in Harvard Yard, attended by graduates who go as far back as 50 years. But today it rained, and indoors, only the graduating class and members of their family could attend. No graduating class of 1968, however, could have picked a more relevant speaker than Mrs. Martin Luther King.
And so I must say that many of the young feel, as I do, that official responses to the frightful and to the personally painful assassinations of these past months have been inadequate. Has not power heard the grim tidings, the anguish from the ghettos, the rural slums, the battlefields abroad? The violence which periodically shocks us in a reflection of the violence to which we have become immune. It is a reflection of the violence our media celebrate. It is, I say, with all due respect to the office of the President of the United States, that even intense prayer and a new commission of notables will not ease the violence in our lives. Though acting forthrightly on the recommendations of the Kerner Commission report might help. This is no time for business as usual, and strengthening the police is business as usual. A tired and false answer. In the passions of recent weeks, I sometimes think that the best of our young do not always understand the extent to which our great universities are authentically the most liberal of our institutions. But the universities, too, must face up to some very hard questions that they have thus far avoided. This war, which is the most cruel and evil war in our history, must come to an end. I call upon the President of the United States to stop the bombing in Vietnam now. this war and the cries of the hungry and the young who have made these their causes, however, will not let them rest, and that is good. There is reason to hope and to struggle if young people continue to hold high the banner of freedom. They have made mistakes and will make more, but the older generation has failed America dismally, and if it is discredited, it has earned its disrepute. It is time for both fresh ideas and new leadership to come forth, because without it, our society is on sinking sand. Historians of the future may record that the alliance of the civil rights movement with the student movement that began in the late 1950s and matured into broad political and social action in the 60s was the salvation of the nation.
Mrs. Martin Luther King addressing the graduating class at Harvard University. And what of the graduating class? Where is it going? What is it thinking?
The affectionate strains of Alma Mater, as sung here at Southern University at New Orleans, will be echoing poignantly over many campuses this week as some 35,000 black students proudly earn their degrees from colleges and universities. To gauge the mood of the graduate and to learn what his involvement will be in a turbulent time of history, Black Journal talked with seniors at schools north and south. First, Harvard University, where members of the Afro-American Student Society spoke out.
We'd all like to think that we're here because we're qualified, but we might as well face some facts. We're here because we're black and because those Mississippi farmers and King and Stokely in the early days got out into the street and raised hell. We're here because we're black. And the only reason that we haven't been murdered like King is not because of our social status or our position here. It's just because that we were absent. We would have been shot down just like he was, you know.
Thank you.
We got to come, you know, we got to face the hard facts and then determine what we're going to do from here.
Right. You know, I think it's important that we don't shut ourselves off, as we haven't during our 4 years or 3 years possibly at graduate school at Harvard, from the community. One problem that we might face, and I haven't faced it yet, but I might going back to my hometown this summer, is the fact that people might, since we've been alienated from the community, they might not be willing to accept us back in the community. We talked earlier of this image of a Harvard man, and they might think that we have some ideas that aren't relevant and pertinent to the black community. Do you see any way that we could actually convince the people that we are still in contact with the people, or do you view this as a problem?
I don't think that's a problem. I think that if we go back with a sincere desire to be of use, that we're going to be recognized as such. I mean, hopefully a lot of us will be able to go back and come on with the vernacular, you know, because that's where we came from. Just be natural and be one of the folks. But if we can't, so what? I mean, the point is that people will recognize us for what we are. If we have Harvard attitudes, damn right they're going to say go to hell, you know. In 10 years, sooner than 10 years, in 5 years, we're going to have a large number of educated but very black people in the market. And if those people use their skills the right way, I mean, that's going to be a hell of a force, man. There's a hell of a lot that we can do together.
Yeah, well, what we're going to do simply is, when we get out of here, is to provide our technical skills and our bodies to the movement. You see, because the movement is not a monolithic front. It's an organic front. There will be people who are concerned with politicizing the communities, people who will be concerned with protecting the communities by any means necessary, and people who will be concerned with setting up businesses. You know, somewhere there's a place for us, most likely in the area of setting up businesses.
At Morehouse College in Atlanta, the graduating class was not unaware of the legacy left by a member of the class of 48. In a dialogue between seniors from Morehouse and co-eds from the sister school, Spelman College, the talk centered on where each would be going after graduation and why.
I'm going in a special program at the University of Chicago Divinity School, in which two quarters out of the academic year are spent in the South Side Training Center of Chicago working with black people. And I chose that instead of going to some academic hall and staying in some bookshelf, because I've been at Morehouse for 4 years and I'm tired of being in buildings, and I want to move out into black communities. And I'm using this as my background.
I want to know, why do you choose to go to Ghana and teach? And if you're so black conscious, why not take a teaching position in some ghetto area
right
in the
here,
United States?
Right here.
I mean, Ghana is there, but I mean, yes, we are right here. Everything is in our midst. Why not here? Are you trying
because
to evade the draft or something?
Because
you know?
At my beautiful 4 years at Morehouse, I did not really comprehend what it means to be a part of black culture. So, if I go to Ghana, it is hope that what I learned there, I can relate to America.
Well, you can go down there. You can go down there, Vine City, and do the same thing as you're doing in Ghana. Rather than help the people here, rather than help your friends and neighbors, you see, you're gonna go over there and help the Africans. Now, I feel no more a part of Africa as a common Anglo-Saxon would feel about the people who came over on the Mayflower. Sure, they're ancestors, but that's it. That's them. That's in the past, you see. Why you want to go back? Why would the Anglo-Saxons, why would the white Anglo-Saxons here want to go over and help the people in Britain, though they might be in slums over there? Why not help the people here?
Wait a minute, Mr. Cook. You said you claim you're worldly. Now, just because I'm going to help those people, that means I'm not helping myself.
Oh, you're helping yourself. Now, you're being egocentric.
Wait a minute, Mr. Cook. Everything is self, regardless of what you do. You know, because if you remember the hunger artist, the reason he didn't like food, he detests food, right? So, you know, he still was getting his satisfaction.
Now, my choice is this, if you're concerned about that. I'm interested in next year working as a field worker with SCLC. Why? Because I want to work with not only black people, but poor people, period. I want to work with all people, you see.
Right.
And I feel that this community, and I do think this is a community, I feel that we should work together, we should work harmoniously, and that we should strive for one end, and that's to get the rats out of everybody's home, get the poor people, get everybody's, get these toothpick legs and these pot bellies off of all the people in the Delta as well as the Appalachian.
If you feel a necessity, Albert, to go and work for SCLC because you want to work with all people, you know, well, that's cool. My own personal feelings are that the problem that exists between the races in America is so mammoth that all black people, particularly black people with any kind of mental alertness, as we should have when we finish college, any kind of political, sociological, psychological, technical, skills or knowledge, that all of this needs to be used in the building of a black community. Because it's one thing that I learned that was obvious to me, you know, that grew out of that whole civil rights movement and the idealism that black people had about America that, you know, sadly enough, we still aren't aware of, you know, just what America really is as a country. But one thing that's obvious.
If the dialogues would fade along with the Georgian desk, the issues and principles would not.
A basic dilemma of America is whether the Negro should be accepted and taken seriously as a human being.
The commencement speaker at Southern University is Ernest Morial of the Louisiana House of Representatives.
The Negro's part in this basic dilemma is whether to persist in his insistence upon his rights as a human being without regard to the risk or consequences, or whether to accommodate to the resistance by subtle or flagrant forms of withdrawal from the fray. For America cannot survive if we do not, and we and no other group of human beings are likely to survive if America does not. You, today's graduates, among the thousands of college graduates of America in 1968, must be the architects of change, the engineers who build and construct a social system within our democracy for our nation to survive.
Rose Williams, William.
Unlike any other black graduating class in history, these young men and women must make up their minds about participating in the black and thus the new American Revolution. Will their search be for middle-class detachment or insightful involvement? This is the mandate to the class of 68.
That was Panchita Pierce reporting for Black Journal. Ralph Ellison has written of the black American as the invisible man. For those who only read the white press, this has long been the case. But for 140 years, there has existed in the United States a black press, born of necessity, which has reflected every shade of opinion from conservative to revolutionary. And the black press is a story in itself. In its beginnings, it filled a vacuum created by the refusal of most white papers to print anti-slavery appeals or notices of abolitionist rallies. The first black paper on record was called Freedom's Journal, and it appeared in New York City on March 20, 1827. It was published by John B. Russworm, a Jamaican, and Samuel E. Cornish of Delaware. The paper's first issue declared, "We wish to plead our own cause. Too long have others spoken for us." Just 2 years later, in 1829, David Walker, a free Afro-American who was a contributor to Freedom's Journal, published Walker's Appeal, a 70-page pamphlet that exhorted slaves to rise up with violence against their masters. In 1847, the black abolitionist Frederick Douglass, a former escaped slave who had bought his freedom, founded his famous North Star in Rochester, New York. The paper helped recruit black regiments in the Civil War. Throughout the 19th century, black papers continued to take up the cry of Afro-Americans for justice, but it wasn't until 1905 when the Chicago Daily Defender appeared with its banner headlines that a black paper appealed to the less educated masses. The black press continued to speak out against racial injustice. Black troops played a prominent role in World War II as they had in World War I, and the Afro-American press was active in denouncing discrimination in the armed forces. The black press today consists of two dailies in Atlanta and Chicago and almost 200 weeklies. These papers are largely unknown to white Americans. In common with the rest of the nation, the black press has mourned the tragic death of Robert Kennedy, long known for a strong civil rights stand. Headline stories point out that two black athletes, Rafer Johnson and Roosevelt Greer, felled the alleged assassin. Of all presidential candidates, Kennedy was the most favored by the black people of America. But curiously enough, Vice President Hubert Humphrey was all along the candidate who seemed to be favored by most of the black press. One observer points out that the black establishment is traditionally tied to the incumbent administration, which Humphrey represents. The death of Kennedy was less shocking to black people than to whites, according to Tom Picot, executive editor of the Chicago Daily Defender. Picot says this is because black Americans live in the shadow of white violence. Donald Mosby is correspondent in Vietnam for the Chicago Daily Defender, which has a circulation of 37,000. He reports an interview he had with Marion Williams, who was the only accredited black woman reporter there. And she told him, "Black soldiers have no business fighting and dying for these people because the Vietnamese people hate them just as they hate the Montagnards, who are black people too." Other charges that black servicemen have been discriminated against and that the Confederate flags have been flown at the naval installation at Cameron Bay have been soft-pedaled by the Navy, says the Defender. Here at home, the Michigan Chronicle, with a circulation of 55,000, regularly honors fallen black soldiers in Vietnam on its front page. Chicago has been quiet for some time after the wave of teenage gang violence, which caused 28 deaths earlier this year. The violence is deplored by Defender staff writer Cheryl Fitzgerald, who says, "The tragedy is that when black youth kills black youth, nobody cares." A bitter campaign by the weekly Carolina Times, circulation 22,000, may prevent the sale of a leading black insurance company to white interest. A financial corporation in St. Petersburg, Florida, wants to buy the Bankers Fire and Casualty Company of Durham, North Carolina, the only black casualty insurance company in America. The Times called on the present owners to stand up like men and not sell out, and the deal is now reported shaky. Incidentally, the Atlanta Daily World reports that the black-owned Atlanta Life Insurance Company recently announced assets of $70 million. Altogether, there are 46 black insurance companies in the United States. And the weekly magazine Jet, with a circulation of 370,000, charges that prominent Afro-Americans are being used by federal anti-poverty forces to spy on the Poor People's March. The magazine says that the group is furnishing hourly security reports on the marchers to the Office of Economic Opportunity. Well, those are just some of the stories that are appearing in the black press. They are stories with a difference, the difference being the unceasing concern of black America with racial injustice. The black press, in fact, often gives full coverage to important stories that would otherwise go unreported. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. left to the people of this land a legacy of love, a dream of peace, freedom, and an end once and for all to the misery of poverty. He challenged the country's conscience. He conceived the Poor People's Campaign, a petition for human dignity to be presented at the gates of power by the mass bodies of the powerless. For a commentary on the progress of the campaign, here is C. Gerald Fraser of the New York Times.
The Poor People's Campaign is more than 6 weeks old now, and the poor that Dr. Martin Luther King wanted to bring to Washington have come. The blacks, the whites, the Puerto Ricans, the Mexican Americans, and Indians. More than 3,000 of them have come from across the country, and, as Dr. King had dreamed, they built a shanty town to expose a nation's shame. They call it Resurrection City, and it sits on the lawn beside the reflecting pool at the Lincoln Memorial. But instead of this as a symbol of the nation's poverty, for many it has become little more than another tourist attraction. Many of the poor who came see their high hopes trickle away in disillusionment. Even a number of those who stay on in the dismal plywood huts seem to have given up on their cause. They realize that the campaign is at a virtual standstill. But perhaps because they have nothing to go back to, they stay and continue to hammer together new buildings and say that they will not leave until the government has dealt with the many problems facing the poverty-stricken in America. There is little doubt that the campaign has lost its momentum. The staff of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference has not devoted adequate time to conducting demonstrations that would dramatize the plight of the poor. Instead, the organization has been bogged down with problems overrunning Resurrection City, a task that has proved larger than most staffers would have believed. There have also been differences among campaign leaders and a lack of organizational planning that has had a telling effect. But Reverend Ralph David Abernathy, Dr. King's successor as leader of the campaign, remains confident. He denies accounts of internal disputes, and he promises that the poor will not abandon their campsite until the government meets their demands, a position that leads some observers to guess that Mr. Abernathy wants a clash with the federal officials, perhaps at the June 19th mobilization or when the permit for Resurrection City expires on June 23rd. For in the opinion of March leaders, only a massive confrontation with the authorities can rally the national support so sorely needed to revitalize this campaign.
New Breed is an organization of some 150 soul brothers who offer new directions in men's clothing, the Afro-American look. New Breed clothes are designed for the black man of today, incorporating elements of his past and present. New Breed is looking toward the day when it will be able to satisfy all black consumer needs. In the words of New Breed president, Jason Bennings, we are quietly building a nation. Corporation, organized in Harlem by Bennings in 1967, is now nationwide with clothing outlets in New York, Chicago, Detroit, Washington, D.C., and Los Angeles.
The measurement of the male, the black male, he's, let's say, slimmer in the waist with a slightly protruding back side with just a little bit heavier chest through here. So this jacket is constructed with this, in, you know, taken in consideration. And this is the thing that's done with the peacock flare. The jacket comes down to the center and out, which causes the peacock flare to open up just slightly. And this is the same thing that we do with the slightly wider lapel. We give the peak to give strength, and also the squared front to also add strength to the garment. Now, the dashiki is an adaptation of an African piece. What we mean when we say dashiki is freedom. So it's a freedom suit. But the dashiki ends up being one of the pieces that have the freedom in the garment itself. In other words, the garment is free. or in this piece, I never am attacked. I could do almost anything, or I could move in any direction. I never feel the restriction of a regular jacket. So this is the new breed piece, is the dashiki suit, is a new breed suit, so to speak. Now we have another thing that we do in the, conventional type suit. It's called a breedall. Milton here has on a breedall. Now the breedall is one piece. It's a takeoff on the overall. See, I used to wear the overall when I was on that farm in Georgia. Now I'm in New York, so this is the breedall. It's a takeoff. He has another job while he's here. So he has a new pair of overalls. So this is the breedall, we call it. The new breed stores aren't just clothing stores. They end up being stores that involve paintings and any number of things that might be reflective of black acculturalization.
It's for the benefit of blacks. It's been a chance for me to get involved in a project with other people that have the same goals.
Milton Clark, in charge of new breed clothing production, cuts the pattern for a summer African print dashiki.
We sell new breed. We sell new breed, which is an idea. Which is an idea. One which says that the black man can do whatever he needs to do to be successful. Being black orientated and being concerned about the lack of progress and the lack of self-determination with black people, I think New Breed is a pretty groovy idea. So that a person that becomes a part of New Breed really becomes a part of the idea of blacks helping blacks. All blacks are new breed, and it's just a matter of pulling a cat's coat and say, hey, you new breed, come on, let's get down, you know? I spend most of my energies trying to make new breed succeed, or enjoying new breed as it succeeds, so that in this sense, the white man is really an irrelevant person. It doesn't really matter that much. And this has been the thing that has enabled us to get as much done as we have. The fact that we have spent our time concentrating on positive things for New Breed rather than negative things for other people.
New Breed financing came from sale of stock to the black community at $1 per share, with additional support from the Negro Industrial and Economic Union headed by Jimmy Brown.
You always get this retort, well, you know, black people and don't know how to run businesses, etc. Now, what we have done is we've disproved that theory, because in the last, say, 5.5 to 6 months, we can't have this.
Ellis Fleming, administrative advisor, discusses the sale of New Breed stock to the black community.
Now, the stock, per se, is we're still selling stock. We're concerned about the guy in the street, the fella in the street that got a couple dollars. When I say we sell them in blocks of 100. Now that was on an installment basis. That was really to get the guy and say, well, look, I own a piece of this. A chick comes in the store up here at the retail shop. She says, well, look, she brings her friends in. It's kind of an elderly lady. I own part of this store. This is my store. Well, we want this because, number one, she brings that in. We want to feel this type of thing. So as far as stock is concerned, everybody can get a piece of the action and really feel that this is really a part of their. Like if they see a garment, that's a part of them. You follow?
Within the New Breed structure, each department has a fundraising thing going on. All right, so that we can have the funds necessary to carry out the next step of that department or that particular company or whatever the thing ends up being, that section, whatever their functions are.
At a Tuesday night business meeting, members of the New Breed Black Communications Department discuss allocation of funds for the organization's Drum magazine to be published at the end of June.
John Hayes got a thing going out there. And Doug is going to set up another thing in Detroit as soon as he gets back over. He's going back over this week.
How are we
going
to do all this?
How are we going to do all this? Yeah. You're a magician. A little black magic. The whole plan, I guess, would be to say that we are attempting to create a nation of citizens of the world. We'd like to go to the point where we free every person in the world that is enslaved.
The new breed, yeah. What's going on? Yeah.
Next on Black Journal, People in the News. Here's William Greaves.
A wide variety of people have made news recently in the nation's black press. In fact, they range from a black Air Force general to the first Afro-American to undergo a heart transplant operation. Patrolman Ronald Smith of the New York City Police died after receiving the heart of a Bronx man who reportedly killed himself. In Richmond, Virginia, the family of Bruce Tucker, whose heart was transplanted to a white man who later died, is suing the doctors involved. The family says the transplant was not authorized by them. Retiring Secretary of Housing and Urban Development Robert Weaver has been the subject of closed-door discussions by organizers of the Poor People's Campaign. They have considered picketing his office because they claim he has done little to improve housing conditions. The Senate's only black member, Edward Brooke of Massachusetts, will be the first senator affected by the Senate's new code of ethics, which begins on June 20th. That's the date on which Brooke's supporters had planned to hold a fundraising dinner to pay off his 1966 campaign debts, a dinner which may now be canceled. The reason? John Stennis, the Mississippi Democrat who heads the Senate's new Ethics Code Committee, has ruled that retroactive fund collecting is unethical. Lieutenant General B.O. Davis, Jr. of the Air Force has been promoted to Chief of the United States Strike Command, in charge of all United States military operations in the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and Africa. The Muslims have reportedly endorsed Wesley South, a black Democrat, in his bid for Congress from a Chicago district. This was the first time that the Muslims have endorsed a candidate of any party. Our profile in the news tonight is the story of a jockey. In the early days of thoroughbred horse racing, black jockeys dominated the field. In fact, the greatest jockey of all time was a black man, Isaac Murphy, who rode 1,420 horses and won almost half the races he entered, including three Kentucky Derbies. Black jockeys have won the Derby 14 times. The immortal Jimmy Wingfield won two straight Derbies and then had spectacular success touring great tracks abroad. However, as racing became a big business, the black jockey gradually disappeared from the scene. Today, there is only one racing at the major eastern tracks. He is 21-year-old apprentice jockey, Ronnie Tanner.
Here at Belmont Park, Tanner is usually out on the track at 6:30 a.m., exercising horses and showing trainers what he can do. In only 9 months of regular racing, he's done remarkably well, winning 70 races and earning $40,000.
Right now, I'm the only one, and most colored boys, Negro boys, they don't go in for it too much. The one thing, they don't have anybody encourage them or anybody to really help them out, like, say, in baseball, football. You have, like, Willie Mays or Maury Will, someone, you know, you admire, you say, well, I sure like to be like him. But in the racing game, you don't have that. Because there's nobody who say, well, I sure like to be like a top rider because there's no, you know, like, which they top color jockeys right now.
Unlike most jockeys, Tanner rarely has a problem making the weight. He averages 105 pounds. However, sometimes he faces the problem of discrimination.
There's quite a few trainers that's already, they will ride you, no matter if I'm white or black. And there's some, because of the color of my skin, they will not ride me. So sometimes I sit and think to myself, well, why can't I ride for them? I know it can't be my ability.
Tanner talks strategy before a race with trainer Imperial and owner John Cheney. Cheney is one of the few black owners in racing.
So just sit back and make your move, you know, and get the job done.
A lot of trainers, they give me compliments on my switching sticks from the right to left and from left back to the right. It takes a lot of ability because you have to do it fast, you know, while the horse is still in motion and running. And then I'm known for finishing real strong on a horse. That means a whole lot. It might mean getting, winning or losing. I'm noted for coming from way off the pace, you know, letting the horses settle the first part of it and make that one big run.
time.
No, no, just a minute here, Bud. Back it up
here. No, no, just one second.
Passing four horses in the stretch, but had to settle for fourth place. We asked him what happened.
The race was run this way I figured it would be run. A lot of speed, and a horse that come from off the pace will probably win it. In which the horse that did win it, he wound up coming from off the pace. And but only thing, he was laying a little closer than what my horse was. My horse, he runs like 15, 20 lengths, no less. He makes that one big run like for half a mile. And usually if there's a lot of speed in the race, the horses start getting tired and come back to him. And he'll pick him up the last part of it and usually win, finish second, and, you know, run a good race.
Are you so tired at the end of a long day today?
Oh, no, not really. I'm still ready to ride. I wish they had a few more races. Just getting warmed up now. Seems like my luck didn't change. I've been riding quite a few horses, but I haven't been able to win the races yet. Before I left Aqueduct, I was seeming to like be doing pretty good. I was winning quite a few races, riding a lot of horses. So I guess this racing luck, because luck plays a big part in this game. At times I say I'd rather be lucky than a good rider.
Huey Newton, the leader of the militant Black Panther Party, will go on trial July 15th in Oakland, California, accused of murdering a policeman. The Black Panther Party has attracted strong national support from radicals and intellectuals, black and white. The Panthers openly advocate the use of guns against the police, claiming that they don't attack, but will only shoot in self-defense, a point disputed by Bay Area law enforcement agencies. The Panthers say this is the only means of ridding the black ghetto of what they call police brutality and oppression. The party was founded in 1966 by Huey Newton, and has membership estimated between 250 and 1,000. Within the last 8 months, their policy and police response has led to two major gun battles and to the deaths of a policeman and a Panther teenager.
Am I telling you to take your hands off me?
The Black Panthers first made national news just a year ago when they entered the state capitol in Sacramento armed with rifles and pistols. They were there, they said, to demonstrate opposition to the proposed legislation that would outlaw the carrying of loaded weapons.
Wait a minute.
Are you under arrest?
Am I under arrest?
I place him under arrest.
Go ahead, brother. Take your hands off me if I'm not under arrest.
Am I under arrest?
I'm telling you to take your hands off me.
In the year following this incident, there were a series of armed confrontations between the Oakland police and the Panthers. The police maintain the Panthers have provoked these incidents. The Panthers claim the police are trying to liquidate their leadership and destroy the party. Last April, when Oakland police stopped a carload of Panthers, a gun battle broke out in this house. The details remain confused, Both sides claimed they fired in self-defense. After 90 minutes of shooting, the Panthers surrendered. The Panthers say 17-year-old Bobby Hutton came out first with his hands up and was shot to death. The police say they thought he had a gun and was trying to escape. Eldridge Cleaver, author of the much-praised book Soul on Ice and Panther Leader, was shot by police and arrested in the incident. Oakland Police Chief Gain.
There have been many people in this city who have maligned this police department, who have, through some maudlin sentimentality or other reason, sympathized with the Black Panthers and the peace and freedom movement. And what real evidence is there to cause people to be so sick as to do that aligning? Take a look at this maudlin, unjustified junk that has been put out. Bobby Hutton, they try to deify one who tried to murder policemen. And what do they say on this piece of paper? A Black man who dedicated his life to defending the Black community from racist oppression was murdered in cold blood by Oakland police. Ridiculous lies, ridiculous attempts to create prejudice. The Black Panther Party poses a real threat to the peace and tranquility of the city of Oakland.
The Panthers have a different version of their role. Huey Newton, Panther leader, will soon be on trial for his life. We asked him about the origins of the party and their concept of self-defense.
We use the Black Panther as our symbol because of the nature of a panther. A panther doesn't strike anyone, but when he's assailed upon, that he'll back up first. But if the aggressor continues, then he'll strike out. He'll wipe out his aggressor thoroughly, wholly, absolutely, and completely. The party is a second party rather than a third party, because we see very little difference as far as Black people are concerned between the Republican or Democratic Party here in the United States. We view ourselves as a colonized people, so we're in a situation of a mother country and a colony. And the politics of the mother country has not answered the needs of the Black subjects in the colony. So therefore, this is the Black political party, and it's a vanguard group for the freedom of Black people. Originally, our party was called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. The name now has been changed to the Black Panther Party, because many people misunderstood the scope of self-defense. The power structure, the establishment, has been aggressive towards us in every area, the social area, the economical area, and the political area. So therefore, we felt it necessary to erect a political party to defend and promote the general interests of Black people. Aggression in the economical area is as real as aggression physically by the racist police that occupy our community as a foreign troop occupies territory.
While continuing their defiant stand against the police, they seek support by running candidates on the white organized Peace and Freedom Party ticket and are publishing their own newspaper. Bobby Seal, Panther chairman.
And this paper is did by Black people.
We're trying to unify Black people around this program here. This is in fact what the program of the party is about. We say we want full employment. Every Black man wants full employment. You know that. We want an end to the robbery by the white man of our Black community. That's what we're talking about, like number three. Number four, we want decent housing fit for shelter human beings. Today. And then we want education for our people that exposes the true nature of this decadent American society. We want education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. We want all Black men to be exempt from military service.
Right.
We want freedom for all Black men held in federal, state, county, jail, city, prisons, and jails, right? You know how Black people is hung up at the man's railroad and through the prisons. You dig? We want an immediate end to police brutality and murder of Black people.
Right.
Basically, we want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace.
We don't want no white man, you know, in our organization.
We don't have white people in the organization. What we do, white people who want to help this organization is so controlled by Black people, we direct those white people what they can do and what they have to do to start stopping that racism. You dig what I'm saying?
Right.
And we don't want them down here in our community controlling us. That's what we talk about.
So tell them to go home and watch their own. Do
go home, restrain the racism now.
The Panthers support this boycott of an Oakland supermarket organized by the Blacks for Justice Committee, whose spokesman is on the Panther Advisory Committee, Paul Cobb.
We checked with the Better Business Bureau and a lot of consumer community organizations about, we've had repeated complaints about the meats here. They're the worst in the city. And the sanitary condition of the store is the worst. 96% of the people who shop here are black, and less than 5% of the people who work here are black. This is inequitable, and this is why we're here. And there is a connection between boycotting here at Housewives and the indictment of the murder of Bobby Hutton. And police brutality is connected because the economic interests that control this city also control the policy of the police department. We're saying that it's regrettable that there's a need for police in this society. But since this society is so racist, we have to have police. But the issue is, who should control those police? And we're saying the black people should control the police. 68% of the policemen in the city of Oakland live outside of the city of Oakland. We're saying that the police must live in the black community so they will have an opportunity to relate to humans properly, and they must be black.
The major issue in race relations in Oakland is the continued friction between the black community and the police. Both sides are holding firm to their positions, and the situation remains potentially explosive. We asked Carlton Goodlett, publisher of the influential San Francisco Black Weekly, The Sun Reporter, for his evaluation and comment.
I believe that the police department is slowly but surely becoming the provocateurs and the inciters of incidents that could very easily lead to the extermination, if necessary, of members of the Black Panther Party. I do believe that the possibilities of racial harmony and peace in Oakland is certainly on trial. If the police respond to the demands of these young people for the ending of two standards of police action, one for white citizens apprehended and one for black, then probably racial peace can be restored in that city. If not, we would see ourselves move precipitously to that separation mentioned in the President's Commission on Civil Disorders of one nation black on one hand and one nation white on the other.
Yesterday in San Francisco, Eldridge Cleaver, Panther Minister of Information and noted author, was granted a writ of habeas corpus, and bail has been set at $50,000. The state is appealing the decision. And now, Black Journal of the Air's News by Dateline. Washington, D.C. This stately home in Washington's Black Gold Coast cost $70,000. Its new occupants will be Stokely Carmichael and, of course, his wife, Miriam Makeba. Neighbors joke that they're living in the most riot-proof area in Washington once the Carmichaels are there. In Durham, North Carolina, the black newspaper, Carolina Times, has gone full circle by recommending a return to the word colored to describe black America. Not Afro-Americans, not Negro, not black, says the newspaper, but colored. It points out that Adam Clayton Powell, for instance, who constantly describes himself as a black man, is less dark than some white Americans. In Richmond, Virginia, the Baltimore Afro-American reports that soul music sensation James Brown was recently banned by the Parks Department from appearing at the Mosque Amphitheater in Richmond. Authorities said that Brown was likely to cause a problem by his habit of hugging and kissing women in the audience. Hollywood solved the problem dealing with race relations in a recently praised film, which asked the question, can a rich, beautiful white girl find happiness married to an average Negro who happens to be a world-famous award-winning doctor whose credentials run longer than the film? Today, network television executives grapple with the enormous problem, how to portray the average Negro in a realistic and courageous manner. The network tries to place Negroes in executive positions where they can be effective, respected, and at times of crisis considered a tower of strength. Black Journal takes you now to Beverly Hills, where a network executive meeting is now in progress.
Hawthorne, we're in trouble. Look at the overnight ratings for our network. We're being beaten by Peyton Place, Sermonette, and the Glutton Market Sweepstakes. We're in trouble, boy.
Well, how about a series about a nun who flies? You know, Debbie Reynolds was a hit in the picture, and we could do a spinoff.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, we could have her help the poor Negroes.
Yeah.
No, that's too chancy. I know. We'll make them Puerto Ricans. They look almost white. Nothing can curse off the relationship.
Hell, who could identify with a Puerto Rican with a beer can in his hand?
Well, we could try. And it'll pick up our ratings in San Juan, Spanish Harlem, and some grape pickers. Better yet, we'll make her a spy for the Vatican. Sort of an ecumenical subversive. How about spies?
I know it's been done, but something different. How about we get a white guy and a black guy as agents for the CIA?
Yeah.
A sort of defiant ones without that chain together bit.
Yeah, like two guys, tough, you know, masculine.
Yeah,
type.
Yeah.
So we don't get all hung up in that, sex thing.
Yeah.
Can you imagine Liberace with a colored partner? Boy, the letters we would get. I gotta take one of my pain pills.
I know spies was my idea, but how about we make them doctors?
Yeah.
Doctors? Huh. Doctors? Are you kidding? Ben Casey and Kildare are dead.
But if we make the colored guy a doctor, white people will love him. They could identify. We can make him a Woody Strode type, you know, gentle as a rose with a constant smile on his face, running around fixing knees and working on a cure for cancer in his spare time in his lab over the garage. A sort of cross between Albert Schweitzer, Jonas Salk, and the Jolly Green Giant. Your average Negro.
Your average Negro.
Now, wait. Just wait a minute, BJ. Just supposing Faye Dunaway hurts her knee in a guest shop.
Mm.
Boy, the letters.
Mm.
He can't touch her knee.
Mm.
No. Spies is it.
Yeah. I will start him out by working for the government. That's typical. Mm.
I got it!
What do you got?
In the first show, we can make the color guy loved by all of white America. Ooh, it's coming out of my head.
Come on.
I feel it. Ready?
Here it is.
You feel it. Go ahead. We can have him running down an American Negro red turncoat. And we can call the turncoat Patrick Henry. Makes it more ironic.
Yeah! And then we can have the colored agent say to Patrick Henry, "You're a disgrace. Just as we're selling the racial situation, you bug out and give the Reds a lot of propaganda. You're a disgrace." And as he reads them out, he can give the Boy Scout sign.
The Boy Scout sign?
Yeah.
That's too obvious. Too obvious.
Well,
say, what about white women on the show? You know, we can't have the colored guy next to white women. A lot of pressure there.
Mm.
Letters. Boy, if he touches Raquel Welch, we're in big trouble.
Why don't we make him a eunuch?
Hey, I got a great idea.
Jay, you're a genius.
I know. We'll do the first season in Hong Kong. I mean, if he gets next to an Oriental chick, who cares?
Then we have the white agent making love to Connie Stevens as the red agent. And the color guy can bow out like he's shy. Or he wants to sing a spiritual at the Hong Kong Hilton.
Yeah. And every time he gets next to a white woman, he can make the Boy Scout sign, you know. So people know his thoughts are pure.
No, that's too obvious, man.
Too obvious.
Now look, we gotta get this colored cat some love.
Mm.
They're gonna think he's some sort of a queer. Why don't we throw him a spade chick every now and then?
Colored.
Cooler. How about a junkie? This way he doesn't get all hung up in a lasting relationship.
Too many spades. Colored. And we're back to Emerson now. Then after we prove the colored guy is straight, true, blue, and trustworthy, we can move the show slowly back to the U.S. for more stories.
Don't rush things, BJ. These things take time.
Mm.
Say, supposing for the second season, we go to Mexico. Now, who cares about Mexican chicks? Hell, man, I don't even drink their water. Besides, Mexicans are a very small pressure group.
Mm.
Well, let's get them a family. A mother. The whole bit. An entire Negro family.
Great!
On TV first.
Yeah.
My God, we'll make history. Probably grab us off a couple of Emmys just for courage.
Wait a minute. Great idea, but will the public accept it? According to our latest surveys, white America will only buy the Negro family if it's a common law relationship. And you know, these people never get married. You can't have a colored agent and an illegitimate kid. Nah, it just doesn't make it. Of course, if we had, it would make it if we had Thurgood Marshall or Ralph Bunch. But they're not available.
Oh, hell. None of that Chitlin stuff and cornpone jazz. We'll just treat them not as Negro, but dark white people. No, none of that civil rights and all that jazz.
Mm.
What they're worried about is straightening Samson's teeth, crabgrass, and trying to keep the national average of 2.2 children per family.
Well done. You're beautiful. You look flushed. Take another pill.
Well, we got all the points covered. Uh-huh. Hey,
we'll win a dozen Emmy Awards, I tell you.
Well, what do you think, Gramercin?
Anything you think, fellas. Look, I got to get back to my desk near the door. The equal opportunity people are coming by this afternoon.
Yeah, you can go straight out your top.
Oh, yes.
It's great to have you on the team.
Oh,
That man's a prince, a tower of strength.
Say, BJ, I just heard that they're putting a Negro family in Peyton Place.
Incredible. I didn't read the book or see the picture.
But do they have a home there?
In New England? Are you kidding?
Well, wasn't there a riot there in 67 or this year? There must be a few of them there.
Well, they wouldn't dare.
And that's Black Journal for this evening. We'll return 1 month from tonight on Wednesday, July 10th, when we'll look at black theater, medicine, and the major events of concern to black America. Juan Gay Segay.
National Educational Television Network.